Hello and welcome to the fourth lesson in nativelang.com's introduction to historical linguistics and language change. Last time around, we looked at some basic words in three Latinic or Romance languages and determined how they were related to each other. We also filled out their family tree back in time and saw that they had this relationship dependent on the existence of some common ancestor that was an actual language spoken in the past. We also determined that if we didn't have attested data for that language, we'd have to go back and reconstruct the language to know what it was like. In this lesson, we're going to do some of those basic reconstructions to determine the shape of an ancestral language that isn't attested. In other words, we have no written records of it. We're going to start with some fresh data from a few new languages. These are all Polynesian languages. I'll start out by saying they're all related to each other. We're not trying to determine here if they're related, but rather what is the common ancestral form that these cognates all share. These cognates all come from some one word in the past. What was the shape of that one word? So here are some words for numbers in these languages. As you can see, the forms are all very close. It's easy to tell, based on this data at least, that the languages are related. I've given you the IPA forms, the International Phonetic Alphabet forms of these words, because we need to look at sounds and sound change to determine how these words changed. If you're not familiar with the IPA, even though the symbols used here are fairly basic, I have a whole lesson on that. I'll put a link to it below. I also need to introduce you to innovations and retentions. Innovations are changes to ancestral forms that were introduced at some point in the past. They may occur in one language, or they may be shared by a group of more closely related languages. Retentions are those forms, in this case the sounds, that go back to the common ancestor. What we need to do is determine which of the sounds here are retentions and which are innovations. Once we can do that, we can posit common forms that must have occurred in the parent or the reconstructed language. One simple innovation shows up pretty quickly as we look at this data. Notice that Hawaiian always has this prefixed material, this e, in front of every single number. This shows up only in Hawaiian and not in any of the other languages. We have good grounds for assuming that this is an innovation. We don't have hard proof here, but the common material to all of these numbers does not include that A. So when we're looking at the Hawaiian numbers, the common material is everything after that A. So let's compare individual sounds. Notice the phoneme T, the voiceless dental plosive, that shows up in most languages. But also notice this curiosity that some languages, instead of having the phoneme T, have this voiceless velar stop instead of the voiceless dental stop. In this case, there's almost something like a democratic vote by the languages against the velar plosive, the K sound, being the original phoneme. We have a pretty good indication that T was an original phoneme, a retention that changed to the innovation K in a specific language, in Hawaiian. So we choose T as the ancestral, inherited, retained phoneme in all of these languages that then changed to a K in some instances. But it would be lazy of us to stop there. We should go and confirm against further data. What we'd find is that this is indeed the case. Where there's a K in Hawaiian, other cognates in other languages have a T, and vice versa. Where there's a T in the other languages, there's a K in Hawaiian. So this seems to be confirmed across the board. We can posit some T in the ancestral language. What's more, we're not surprised to find that the number 7 has a form with T and not with a K in that ancestral language. So our reconstruction of that root is pretty straightforward. The question becomes a bit more complicated when we look at L's and R's. Take a look at the word for the number 2 and for the number 3. And the number 8 in the Polynesian languages that we have here. Should the reconstructions of these languages have an L or an R? One thing to notice here is that languages that have an L seem to always have an L, and languages that have an R seem to always have an R. And there's a good distribution here, so which one should we choose? As I mentioned, this isn't so straightforward. What we'll need to do is to extend our comparison to other languages. These languages aren't as closely related. They'll give us some comparative evidence for the distribution of L's and R's throughout the whole family. You can see in these languages that L and R are distinct phonemes. In other words, L doesn't always show up when R does. What's even more important is that these languages are consistent in their distribution of L and R. So it's reasonable to suppose that this distinction was also made in the common ancestor language that's the parent of the Polynesian languages we're evaluating. Based on this evidence, we'll reconstruct the numbers 2 and 3 this way. We can then conclude that some of the daughter languages changed all instances of L's and R's to R, and other daughter languages changed all instances of L's and R's to L. When it comes to sound change, there's a lot going on. There are reasons for seeing typological characteristics. In other words, these types of sound changes tend to happen, these other ones don't or are less common. So we have grounds for saying that the change from the phoneme F to the phoneme H is a common and expected one. But we wouldn't expect H to turn into F, and the same goes for V and W. We commonly expect a W to turn into a V-like sound. On top of that, there are regular types of sound changes that happen in languages, and these are especially important for understanding language change. If you'd like to take a look at those types of regular sound changes like assimilation, which I believe I've mentioned before in a previous lesson, to get a more in-depth understanding of assimilation, dissimilation, things like metathesis, compensatory lengthening, and so on, I put together a brief page with definitions and examples. I'll leave you the URL for that page as well. I really hope this lesson's been helpful for you. I know it's a brief introduction, but take a look at the site. You'll get more information there and a couple of exercises as well. Thanks for learning with me.